It's good to see you all here. My name's Dr. Rodney Orr. I'm the chairman of the World Missions and Intercultural Studies Department, and we're excited that you're here. By the way, all of you in the back, if you want to come, there's lots of seats up here. Come on up and grab a seat, okay? When the Reformation occurred, things like sodalities that helped to send out missionaries were dropped, and they were dropped because they felt that the Great Commission had been fulfilled in the first century, that Matthew 28, 18, and 20 had been done. And so for 200 years, there was basically very little cooperation in terms of missions until something happened in 1797, when a guy named William Carey decided to mobilize missionaries. There were other missionaries before him, but Carey got this idea of mobilizing people to go into all the world. We were at a picnic in Aspen, Colorado, and a beautiful place. And we just happened to sit next to the Mikalatoses and their three little girls, and we just have never forgotten that time. One day my daughter came home from a conference called Big Break in Panama City, Florida, and she said, "Mikalatos." It was a great experience. And one time at Colorado State University, we heard 5,000 missionaries were in a room singing worship like you were just now. And he was speaking, and it was such a blessing. And we invited him because he's a mobilizer, that we are trying to mobilize people to go into all the world, and we're just excited that he's here with us. And also his wife, Krista. Can you just stand, Krista? Matt is an author, a husband, a father, who is passionate about Jesus, telling stories, and learning how to share God's love with the people around us. He has been on staff with Crew for 16 years and lives in the Portland, Oregon area with his wife and three daughters. His wife, Krista, earned her master's degree in cultural anthropology, has been a seminary and college professor, and is also on staff with Crew. Matt has published 6 books, which take a variety of different forms and genres. Matt has been writing consistently since college, though he didn't start getting paid until he started writing for the late, great Wittenberg Door, a Christian satire magazine. He loves fiction more than just about any other thing in writing, and can often be seen with his nose in a book or reading a comic. He strongly believes there is room for more voices in the Christian arena, and that people should write about what they truly love, not trying to fit into a predetermined mold. He is glad to talk about writing until you get a little bored and slowly inch away, making some excuse about needing to go to class. We welcome Matt as this year's plenary speaker. May he challenge us, may he mobilize us to be better representatives of Christ to the people of our world today. Matt?
I'm excited that you're doing evangelism this afternoon. I'm actually going to lunch with an atheist friend of mine who lives here locally. And the first time we got together, he said, "Are you going to try to convert me?" And I said, "Are you going to try to convert me?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Okay, good." So we're good now. His first argument was, "I don't have to go to church on Sunday." And I was like, "I go Saturday night." So anyway. Neither of us are making much movement so far, but we're going to have lunch today. We enjoy each other. I want to tell you one story. If you've seen me speak almost anywhere, I almost always tell this story when we're talking about evangelism because I love it so much. The idea behind it being that we shouldn't write people off because we think they're far from Jesus. So if this is the moment of conversion, if this is the zero point and negative 20 is as far away as you can get, and positive 20 is in the presence of the Lord and knowing things and growing for a millennium or so. You know, we get really focused on this idea, if you're negative 20, you're not gonna get to zero very quickly. But that's not always the case. So when I was first learning how to do evangelism with Crew, My trainer took me out in Seattle on the campus there, the University of Washington at Seattle. And he said to me, it's your turn to pick someone, a random stranger, for us to talk to about Jesus, which is horrible. Everyone hates it, right? And even the people who do it all the time largely hate it. So I said, okay, here's my technique. Find someone alone. Find someone studying, because they don't want to do that. And then I had this like genius question to start things off. So we go up, I find this guy, he's alone, he's reading a physics book, and I walk up to him and I say, hey, do you want to talk about spiritual things? And he was, and this is the Northwest, right? He goes, yeah. Closes his book and he pushes it aside. I was like, oh, well, that's weird. Okay, yeah, I mean, we all hate physics. I mean, especially the Christians. But anyway, so I sit down with him. Oh, yeah, you know you hate it. Stop moaning. So I sit down with him and my friend Brian. We sit down. And I said, okay, you reacted really strongly saying you want to talk about spiritual things. Why is that? And he said, oh, I'm Buddhist. In fact, I'm a really strong Buddhist. In fact, my whole family's Buddhist, and they're always like, why do you have to be so Buddhist all the time? And I was like, oh, totally wasting my time. All right. Well, I've chosen poorly. So I said, yeah, okay. So why do you love the Buddha so much? And he starts to tell me. And to be honest, the teachings of the Buddha, many of them are really beautiful. There are a lot of gorgeous things about Buddhism. So he starts to talk about those things. I was like, yeah, it's good. And then as he's been talking for a while, he finally stops and he goes, you know, there's only one thing that bothers me about the Buddha. I said, well, what is that? He said, well, the Buddha said, I'm not God. You shouldn't worship me. But really, in Buddhism, that's basically what we do. We worship the Buddha. And I wish there was just a guy who came along and said, I am God. You should worship me. And I was like, I said, I totally know a guy. And he was like, really? So I walk him through the whole thing, right? Here's what Jesus said. Here's how it worked. And kind of got to the end. I said, it was a little 5-minute presentation about Jesus. I said, what do you think? And he goes, guess I'm a Christian now. So there you go. Negative 15 to 0 in a 15-minute conversation. That's pretty good. Why? Because Jesus was already revealing himself to him through the Buddha. That's amazing. That's beautiful. So I can't make assumptions about someone I'm sitting down with or speaking to that they're not, that it's not my job to decide who's ready for Jesus. That's between them and the Lord. And I can have a conversation with anyone and trust that God is already working in their lives in some way, if we can get the conversation to that place. So I'm excited for you. One of the side effects of that, by the way, is that I have fallen in love with talking to people who are the furthest from Jesus. Like my friends, a lot of them who are in ministry know that if they're like, hey, this person is basically ready to pray to receive Jesus, and this other person over here is a Satanist and hates everyone, who do you want to talk to? I'm like, oh, Satanist. Give me the Satanist, please. You go take care of the other, yeah, ready to pray to Jesus, whatever. You take care of them. And I have great stories about some of those people. Krista doesn't always like who I run off to talk to, but we figure it out. My first trip, we were overseas in East Asia for 3 years. It's a place where it is technically illegal to share the gospel, which is why I say East Asia. And I remember once being in a dorm room with six students. There's six students in this particular dorm at this school. And we were sitting around talking, and one of them says, you realize the things you're saying, it's illegal for you to share those with me. And the police could come and you could get arrested. And I was like, oh, well, maybe we shouldn't tell the police then. And they all started to laugh, and they said, oh, don't worry, you're our friend. And I was like, so you want to hear this? They're like, oh, yeah. Okay, good. Oh, good. The first time I went to East Asia, though, the first time I'd ever been there, I hadn't really been out of the country much. I'd been to Mexico a few times. I'd been in Canada long enough to, like, see that the back of G.I. Joe figures had English and French, you know, when I was a kid. So that was about it. That was my international experience. So I was very excited to go overseas. And I remember on that first trip, usually when you arrive, right, when you go to another culture, whatever culture, there's this sort of, they call it sometimes the honeymoon period, where everything's amazing, where you're like, that's incredible. And I remember landing and I'm like, I can't read any of the signs. I'm illiterate. That's incredible. You know, or walking outside and seeing these trucks, giant trucks full of pigs, living pigs, going off to restaurants. I was like, oh, pig trucks. Whoa, it's cool. Like, I was really into it, right? And there were so many beautiful things. I love the way people drove. Like, at that time, it was still legal to honk your horn constantly. And I really thought you could probably close your eyes and drive because everyone was honking. You could tell just by listening. Oh, yeah, we're fine. We can change lanes. So, you know, stuff like that was incredible. Everyone was on a bicycle. The language sounded so different to me. The people were friendly. The food was different and amazing, foreign, new, exciting, everything. Yeah, I was like, this is a different people for sure. And then one day in this first week that I was there, we went to this restaurant and a waitress came over. She was wearing, I remember it so vividly, she was wearing a kind of traditional blue shirt. And she came to take our order, and I looked up and saw that she had an enormous black eye. And not a, like, I fell off my bicycle black eye, but one that was shaped like a fist. Like, clearly she had been punched hard in the face. And she hadn't really done anything to hide it, this huge, swollen black eye. And that was the moment I realized, oh, so we're not so different after all. We're the same in a lot of ways. And I had to stop and say, okay, we say, my theology is, God loves human beings. I would say, God loves everyone. So God loves human beings, but then how do we explain domestic abuse? Or the heat wave in India last year that killed over 2,000 people just because it was too hot. Why are we still trying to explain to other human beings that Black Lives Matter? Why is that? And if he's so loving, if God's so loving, where was he when the terrorists rolled out with their machine guns and bombs in Paris? Where was he in San Bernardino? Where was he in Israel today when someone went through a crowd with a knife? Where was he on April 21st last year when a boat weighed down with refugees capsized off the coast of Sicily and 800 people drowned, including women and children? Where was he? Where was this loving God? And that's not counting our personal tragedies, the things that happen to us, our loved ones who are lost to us, or breakups, or divorces, or abuse, or our friends who have cancer, our children who are sick, the everyday injustices and pain and suffering of life. I thought you loved us. So what kind of love is that? And we look around at this world and sometimes we have to ask, we have to if we're being honest about the things we see, the things we experience. We must ask, where are you? How are you not here? How can you let us suffer? How can he let us be harmed? How can he let us harm one another? Does he really love us? Or maybe he loves us, but he doesn't have the power to change things. Maybe that's the problem. I think in many ways, this is the hardest question we can be asked in evangelism. Almost any other question, you can pull out a pretty easy answer somewhere. But this question, this one, is difficult, I think. And the answer sometimes we give, well, God does all things for good. He's in control. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm not saying it's theologically incorrect, but I will say it's insufficient. Krista and I, some time ago, went through a series of miscarriages. And I promise you that if I had come to you and said, what is going on with this? I'm hurting. And you said to me, oh, God's in control, that I might have sat there politely, maybe, if you were lucky, but that it didn't bring healing in my life. It didn't bring peace. And the problem is that this answer by itself, especially with people who aren't walking with Jesus, who don't know him, who don't trust him, who aren't in relationship with him, that the answer, that answer says, so you're saying that God has a higher capacity for human suffering than I do? I'm saying this is a terrible thing, an injustice in the world, and you're saying God knows and he's in charge and it's okay? And you're saying that's someone worth following. So you're saying, maybe, I went through some sort of abuse, and you're saying that that was God's plan? You're saying he did this to me? And now you have the audacity to tell me that he loves me? So you're saying that your God is a monster. That's what you're, I mean, yeah. That is what you're saying. That seems clear. Let me share with you during the time of our miscarriage and other difficulties in our life the story that has been most meaningful for me and that I found most helpful in talking to people about the pain and suffering of the world. And it's John chapter 11, which is the story of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And of course, Jesus enters into the story as well. I know some people get a little concerned when a speaker pulls out a phone to like look at the Bible. And I just want to say that I'm a traditionalist and I prefer scrolls, so that's why. If you guys want to use your newfangled book technology, I mean, go ahead. So, John chapter 11. Mary and Martha's brother has fallen ill, but they're not worried because they have a friend who they know loves them. They've seen him do incredible miracles. He's taken sick people and put his hand on them, and they've been well. Blind people, crippled people. So why would they be worried? Why should they be concerned when they can just send him a text and say, Jesus, the one you love, he's sick. And they know he'll come running because he loves them. Now, a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary, and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sister sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. We know you love us. Lazarus, we know you love him. He's sick. And when he heard this, Jesus said, oh, this sickness won't end in death. No, it's for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. And then listen to verse 5. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. This is one of the only places in Scripture where it specifically points out the names of individuals and says, these are people Jesus, the human Jesus, the incarnate Jesus, loved by name. Mary, Martha, Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he loved him. So he stayed where he was for a couple of days. And then he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. And they said, but teacher, a little while ago, people tried to kill you there, and you're going to go back. Okay, Jesus, let's talk this out. You want to go back? They're going to try and kill you. We just want to, what's the plan? And Jesus said, okay, let me clarify. Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by the world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light. And the disciples all said, okay, I don't know what you're talking about. Like, seriously, why do you say stuff like that all the time? I don't understand. And then Jesus just like stared, so they just stared at each other for a long time, I'm pretty sure. He was like, hours of light, and they're like, I don't know. And then he goes, okay. Let me try again. Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. And they said, yeah, but sick people, you're supposed to let them sleep because then they get better. And now Jesus is starting to get frustrated. And he says to them plainly, which he doesn't do often, he's like, do I have to spell it out for you? Lazarus is dead. And they're like, oh, well, that's not good. And he goes, and for your sake, I'm glad I was there, not there, for their sake, not for Lazarus' sake, not for Mary's sake, not for Martha's sake, for your sake, I'm glad I wasn't there so that you might believe, but let us go. And then Thomas, who we like to call Thomas the doubter, which I think is super unfair. He's more like Thomas, the cynical guy who says whatever he's thinking. Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, we should go along so that we get murdered with him. Thanks, Thomas. Good idea. Let's go. So this is where it starts. And then Jesus comes, and we see this really interesting thing. It says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. And it was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. So there's mourners there. People showed up with casseroles, right? Which I don't know why that's the universal grieving food in the United States, but there you go. So they got their casseroles, and they got the people there taking care of them, helping with things to help Mary and Martha in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she ran out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. And when she saw him, she said this, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Where were you? You say you love him. I know you have the power. So where were you?" And then she says this, I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. So she doesn't come straight out and ask for anything. But she says, even now, if you asked for something, I think that God would give it to you. And Jesus says, oh, your brother will rise again. Sounds like this theological answer. Well, there's a day coming, right? You've probably heard that at funerals. Your friend dies, your family member dies, and someone goes, don't worry. One day they're going to rise again. So what? Well, how's that help me today? Great. And Martha says, yeah, I know. I know he'll rise again on the last day. That's really clear. Everyone knows this. Thanks for the platitude. And Jesus said, oh no, you don't understand. I'm not saying one day there's an event called the resurrection. I'm saying I am the resurrection and the life. It's not an event, it's a person. You're in relationship with the resurrection. I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she said, yes, I do. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. And this is interesting, right? So Jesus starts with this idea of saying, death is only temporary, Martha. You will see Lazarus's face again, which is beautiful. It's this promise of the future, of what we hear later that John writes about in Revelation chapter 21. Now the dwelling of God is with humanity, and he will live with them. They will be his people. He will be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. And it's an interesting scripture in Revelation when he says that he will wipe every tear from their eyes and there will be no more crying. Because what does that mean? What are the tears he's wiping away then? It's the tears for the things that have happened in this life, for our trouble, our pain, our loss here. A time is coming when he will comfort us for those things and we'll have healing complete enough that we'll no longer cry for those things. So that's coming. All that is broken will be repaired. All that is lost will be found. There'll be no more children on the street, no more parents abusing kids, no more war, no more poverty, never again. It's done. It's gone. So that's what he's saying when he says, your brother will rise again. It's an answer about our future hope. It's a reminder that today is not the end of history. That when we walk around our neighborhoods and cities and battlefields and graveyards, it's not the end of the story. In time, God will abolish death. In time, we'll see our loved ones' faces again. In time, all that is broken will be repaired. And Martha, of course, responds that she knows that. And that's where Jesus talks about himself as the resurrection. That not only do we have a future hope, not only are there good things to come, but also that we have a present hope that he is with us. He is here today. He is the resurrection. And in that sense, in that relationship, we experience resurrection here, now, not in the future. But of course, what is What is the response of Mary when she sees Jesus? Let's take a look. After she said this, this is verse 28, Martha went back and called Mary aside. She said, "The teacher is here and he's asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Jesus hadn't come into the village yet. He was still on the outskirts of town, still at the place where Martha had met him. And when those who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn her brother there. And when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Where were you? Where were you?" And when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he stopped and explained the theology to them so they would feel better. Oh, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "Look how much he loved him." And others said, "If he loved him so much and he had the power to open the eyes of the blind, couldn't he have kept him alive? I guess he probably doesn't love him that much." Because where was he? Where was he? So Jesus sees Mary and friends weeping and is deeply moved in spirit and troubled, and he weeps. Why? Well, you can read entire libraries of books trying to explain why. There are all these theories about why Jesus weeps. I think when we parse this down into a scholastic argument, a lot of times we lose the reality of how complicated it is when a human being weeps and how many conflicting emotions even can be present in the midst. But we do know this, that the thing that starts it is Jesus seeing the suffering of Mary and her friends. That's what starts the weeping. It's not that Lazarus is dead necessarily, because he knows Lazarus will rise again, not even in the future. He knows it's going to happen today. That's his plan. That's why he's here. So it's seeing the grief of Lazarus's friends that starts the tears brimming in his eyes. And in the midst of our troubles and sorrows, in the midst of a broken, sinful world, Jesus sees our suffering and he weeps with us. He experiences sorrow and loss to see us, his loved ones, experiencing sorrow and loss. I've heard people say, Christian people, good people, who I respect enormously, say, "Be strong. Don't cry. Remember the future. God is in control. Keep it together. Dry your eyes before you come into church. Let people know when they ask you, 'How are you since your dad died?' And you say, 'Oh, it's hard, but the Lord is in control.'" I've heard people say that. Don't mourn with people who are weeping. I don't think, this is not for the followers of Jesus. It's not. A follower of Jesus is someone who wants to be like him. And what did Jesus do? He cried when he saw people in pain. He wept with them, and so should we. We don't need to hold back our tears. So Jesus does these three things in response to our pain. He reminds us of our future hope, which is a good thing, a thing that many of us default to, but Jesus does that. He reminds us that he's with us, that he's present with us, that he loves us, that he's here, and he weeps with us. And in time, he shows us the power and glory of God. Lazarus rises. So as a follower of Jesus, what do I do when I see difficult things in life? I've heard people say, I have friends, I know people who have said, the suffering in the world is too great for me to continue to follow God. How can a good and loving God do these things? I'm done. And they've walked away. I have a lot of atheist friends that was the question that started them down the road to walking away from Jesus. And I understand. I do. I think they've misunderstood something. And that's this. If I'm a disciple of Jesus, the question in these situations is not, where was Jesus? But where was I? Where was the church? Where were his followers, his representatives, his servants? Because if I'm in the midst of these difficult things and saying, where is God? And he says, you're my representative. What am I doing? Why am I not stepping in? Why am I not representing him? Why, when someone's weeping and they're saying, I just need to be comforted, where's God? How can I not put my arm around them? Because I am here to represent him, to show that God is present. I can put my arm around someone who's lost someone they love and say, one day there'll be a resurrection, you'll see your father again. And today God is here with you, and I'm so sorry for your loss. We can cry together. When I see a homeless woman, there was a woman in Portland that I met. She was young, pregnant, on drugs. Where's God there? Well, yeah, I bought her a meal, gave her my number. I introduced her to some people in the Christian community who are making a difference there. That's where God is. He's there. He's working through his people in the midst of that. In the midst of war, I can remember that Jesus is present with me and that he is the Prince of Peace, and I too, with God's help, can work to bring peace. And when I can do nothing else, when all I can do is this, I can stand with those who've lost loved ones or in pain and put my arms around them. And because I'm someone like Jesus, I can weep with them, hopefully. Paul said to us, let the peace of Christ reign in your hearts. If peace reigns, then it's in control. The peace of God controls our lives. Let the peace of Christ reign in our lives. When his peace reigns, we don't make decisions out of worry or fear or anger. And right now in the United States, that's happening a lot. People are making decisions out of fear, out of anger. Not if the peace of Christ is reigning in our hearts. We cannot do that. We can't. Instead, we let him speak in the midst of our storms to say, peace, be still. And we look at the broken darkness of the world around us, and as we ask that question, what kind of love is this? We must deal with the reality that God has made it very clear in Scripture, that he does love the people of the world, just like it says he loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus, that yes, God loved the world so much that he did what? That he sent his son. He told us that he came to heal the brokenhearted, to fix the broken, to set people free. So he loved the world so much that he sent his son. And when we in the community of faith ask, well, how much did God love us? We say, how great is the love that God has lavished on us, that we should be called God's children. So he loved the world so much that he sent his son, and he loved us so much that he said, be my children. And that is what we are. So why would we think, why would we ever for a moment imagine that he would treat us any differently than his other son, who he loved the world so much that he said, I'm sending you my son. We're his children. And he looks at the brokenness of the world and he says, my children will come to you to show you how much I love you. That's beautiful. That's amazing. He loved the world so much, he sent his son. He loved us so much, he lavished us in love by adopting us as his children. And then he showed his love to the world by sending us. By sending us. All our messed up, broken issues to show people he loves you. He does. A couple quick stories. I was in Costa Rica years ago with a summer mission trip, mostly college students. And I have terrible, terrible Spanish, really awful Spanish. I'm so sorry, people who speak Spanish. My kids speak fluent Spanish and they always say, please, Dad, stop speaking Spanish. But I have what I like to call restaurant Spanish, which means I'm like, más burritos, por favor. And that's like enough to get me through the day. I went with a woman named Adina off into campus in Costa Rica, and we saw a group of students sitting down, and we decided to try and speak to them, to share the good news about Jesus. And here was our stunning evangelism opener question. Get ready for it. You might want to write this down. It was this: do you speak English? That's where we started, because we weren't certain that the holy fire would come upon us to help us with the Spanish. I mean, if it happens, it's good, but we weren't planning on it. So we walk up, we sit down with these girls. There were four of them, and a few of them spoke English, and we said, could we talk about spiritual things? And they said yes, because they were studying. So such a good strategy with college students. So we pulled out this little tract, little religious tract in Spanish, and because we're with CRU, Campus Crusade for Christ, we said, could you please read to us El Cuatro Leyes Espirituales? And they were like, sí. So they opened the book and they read it aloud in Spanish. They went all the way through. And really the book says, right, God loves you. We are sinful and broken, separated from God. God loved us so much that he made a solution, which was the death and resurrection of Jesus, his son himself. And that we can enter into this relationship through accepting Jesus's offer of eternal life and saying that we believe these things to be true. So the girls read through it and we say, what do you think? And the first girl said, I need to go to class. She left. The second girl said, I know all these things. I'm Catholic. I've heard these many times. Okay. Third girl, interested, but didn't think much of it. The fourth girl said this: every night before I go to bed, I pray and I say, oh God, if you are real, please show yourself to me. And we said, what do you think? And she said, I think you've come here as an answer to my prayers. And the thing is, she's not unique in the world. There are people all over the world making that prayer. And this will probably surprise you, but many of my atheist friends tell me that they pray. They don't advertise it. They don't put it on their Facebook walls. I had one atheist friend who for like 3 months sent me a prayer request every week. And one of her prayers was, if God is real, I don't want to miss it. Tell him to show me. Another story. Yeah, you saw my book Sky Lantern earlier today. I want to tell you the story behind that book. One day, about a year ago, it was raining, and there was a piece of garbage in our front yard. It was a big plastic bag. And we live in a cul-de-sac, so we get garbage all the time coming in. I mean, it's like one time I found a full can of cat food. Like, I don't know how it happens, but that's what it was. Beer cans, microwave burrito wrappers. It's just constant. So one day there was a large, what looked like a plastic bag. And Krista said to me, did you notice that there's a big piece of garbage in our front yard? Which translated in our marriage meant, would you please walk outside and pick that up? And I said, I noticed that, which is my way of saying, my healthy communication style of saying, it is raining. I do not want to walk out there. I'll pretend not to know what you're talking about. And then she kind of upped the ante. She got in the car to take one of the kids somewhere, and she drove over the garbage, and she went somewhere, and then she called me and said, I noticed that piece of garbage was still out there, which was, again, I knew what this meant, but what it meant was, you will not win this. So, fine, I'll go get the garbage. So I walk out, it's still raining, it's not terrible, and this piece of garbage, though, this plastic bag, it was about this big, it wasn't a plastic bag at all. It was a sky lantern. I don't know if you've seen these. They're paper lanterns, like hot air balloons. They get about this big, and then you light a fuel cell, and, you know, they fill with hot air, and they fly. Well, yeah, they're super dangerous. And written on it were the words, I love you, Dad. I miss you so much. And a heart, and the girl's name, Steph. And I stood there in the rain, kind of taken off guard by suddenly seeing the brokenness of another person who I didn't know. There was no way to contact her. She didn't have her phone number on there. And I was so just sad for this woman. And I remember picking up my daughter from ballet later that day, and one of her friends was with her. And I was telling them about it while I was driving home. And she said, "Dad, you're acting so weird." I was like, yeah. So that night I thought, well, what could I do? What could I do? So I wrote a letter to her. I've got my three daughters. And I thought, as a father, if I passed and this happened to someone else with my kids, I'd want them to do something. So I wrote this letter to this woman, Steph, and I just said, "Steph, if you're, I mean, it was more than this, but Steph, if your dad were able, he'd want to say these things to you, that he loved you, that he's proud of you, and that he'd want good things for your life, and that love is as strong as death. It's eternal. It's powerful. It comes for everyone. It can't be escaped, and he'd want you to live a good life." So I wrote this letter. I put it up on my website. I didn't think much of it. The next morning, I'm doing the dishes before school, and one of the kids comes up, and she just hugs me, and she's crying. I was like, what is happening? I mean, in a house, you know, it's Krista, our three girls, and me, so almost every day someone cries in our house. I mean, 75% of the time it's me, but this happens. So I was like, well, that's weird, but it's not super weird. But then she just cried, she hugged me, and then she went upstairs. I was like, huh. So I went upstairs to see what was happening. I walk in, and my wife, Krista, is sitting on our bed, and she's crying. And I was like, okay, now what is going on? And she said, oh, Allie just showed me your letter. And yeah, that's why everyone's crying. And that day, the letter started to spread as people found it on social media and they shared it. Their losses, their fathers that they missed or who they still wanted to express something to, or father saw it and said, I want to make sure my kids see this. And it started to go literally all over the world and got hundreds of letters over the next several days. I had to take a couple days off work to answer them all. The letters were things like a woman wrote and said, my husband just died. We have three children under the age of six. And I'm keeping this letter to let them know this is how your dad felt about you. A woman in Germany wrote me and said, my dad was never able to say these words, though I know he would have wanted to. And so I've printed the letter out and I fold it up and I keep it in my purse. Anyway, it was all, Krista actually finally asked me, I would wake up every morning, open my laptop and start reading, and she said, could you please stop that? Because I was crying every morning when I woke up before I got out of bed. Which is, have breakfast first and then have an emotional breakdown. Here's the really interesting thing. This woman, Steph, found me eventually. She knew some other things written on the lantern that I hadn't shared with others. It was a pretty amazing moment. It was a month and a half later, maybe. So we end up talking on the phone. We become friends. I've been to visit her twice. She's come out to visit our family. Steph, at the time we first started speaking, was an atheist. And her dad was Catholic. And before he passed, they were having a conversation. She said, Dad, you don't need to be afraid about what comes after you die because you just go to sleep and there's just nothing. You don't have to worry about a judgment, nothing like that. And her father became really angry. And he said, Steph, if there's any way to show you that there's life after death, I'm going to. So she was understandably freaked out when she got the letter. And she asked me, Matt, were you possessed by my dad? And I said, Steph, that's super creepy. That is not what happened, so far as I know. Like, I'm pretty sure no. But what's interesting is, right, what happened here? Here was a woman in a lot of pain over something that, let's be honest, is incredibly normal. 100% of us lose people we love to death if we're fortunate to live long enough. And I just entered into that conversation with her, and what it brought us to was this question. Matt, if there's a God, it's the atheist asking, if there's a God, what is he like? And did I pull out a bunch of Bible verses? No, not at that moment. I said to her, in her language, in her question, in her pain, I said, Steph, if there's a God, I believe he's a father God. And that all the things I wrote in that letter that your dad would want to say to you, that God would want to say those things to you too, that he loves you, that he's proud of you, that he wants good things for your life. And she said, we can't talk about this anymore. I just need time to process, which is fine. We've had a lot more conversations since then. And she would say today, she's a deist. She thinks there's a God of some sort. She believes in an afterlife. And I asked her, what about Jesus? Are you on board with Jesus? And she said, I don't know what he's talking about. And I said, that's okay. Most of us aren't sure what he's talking about, like a lot of the time. And you can follow him and not be sure what he's talking about. So that's where we are right now. Wonderful, beautiful, amazing woman in pain, needing to hear not God took your father from you, but to hear God loves you and he wants good things in your life and that he cares about your pain. So in this, it sounds like this amazing occurrence, this incredible thing. I introduced her to one of my Christian friends in the town she lives in because it's pretty far. She lives in Salt Lake City. The wind blows the other way from our house to Salt Lake City. So everyone's like, how did the lantern get there? And I'm like, it hit the front of a Mack truck, it got driven cross country, and then the trash just comes to our house. That's how it works. We get trash all the time. How did it get here? I don't know. But I introduced her to one of my Christian friends, and my Christian friend said, I don't know what to do. How do I share the gospel with her? And I said, Julie, this woman lost her dad, wrote on a sky lantern that she missed him, which somehow came to my house in such a way that I found it and was moved enough to write a letter to put on the internet that went viral so that she could see it, so that we could be in relationship, so she could hear not only that her father loved her, but that God loved her. Just relax. I don't think she's getting away. Right? And the thing is, it's not uncommon. People come to Jesus in spectacular, weird ways every day, every single day. Because why? Because he loves them. And he loves them enough that he sent Jesus, and he loved us enough that he adopted us as his children, and he loves them enough that he says, I'm sending my kids to you. Just like I sent Jesus. That's what Jesus said, right? In John, in the John account of the Great Commission, he breathes on them. The holy breath, the Holy Spirit. He breathes on them and he says, as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you, which is by far the most complicated of the Great Commissions because you have to read the entire book of John and look at all the ways that God has sent Jesus to understand that he's saying, yeah, that's true for you too. It's amazing. It's incredible. That's a free book idea for anyone who's trying to write a book. Go for it. I'm not going to do it. It's a lot of work. Yeah, listen, this isn't an amazing occurrence. This woman in Costa Rica who is praying every day, send someone to tell me you love me. This woman who sent a sky lantern. This Buddhist kid who became a Christian because of the Buddha. This isn't weird. This isn't strange. This is every day. And right now, today, I promise you, in East Asia, there's a college student lying on her bunk bed, staring at the wall, praying, if there's a God, show me that you love me, and someone here in this room might be an answer to that prayer. That right now in Moscow, there's a man who just lost his wife in a car accident. In Sydney, Australia, there's a guy with the hardest heart you've ever seen who's doing his best to push everyone away so they won't see how much he's hurting. In Turkey, there's a student who wants nothing more than to go downtown and party away from his parents so that for a moment he can forget how lonely he is. In St. Lucia right now, there are people recovering from the devastation of their families several years ago. In India, there's a student trying to get out to get an education on a higher level than their parents so that they can get out of the life they're in and try something different. And all of these people, all of them, are people who need to know that God loves them and God has said to us, go tell them, let them know. And right now in Dallas, there are people wondering if they're loved. And they live a couple blocks from this seminary. They're standing around and we're walking past them as we go to get a meal, doing our best not to notice them because of the frayed cuffs on their jeans. At the Starbucks, the homeless guy ordering a coffee. And we're trying not to speak to him, not to notice him, not to see him. Right now, there are people in Dallas wondering if they're loved. And today, this afternoon, you're going to have the great privilege, the invitation to go and speak to them and to tell them, yes, yeah, you are. You're loved. Because God loved the world so much that he sent his son. And he loved us so much that he adopted us as his children. And then he loved the world so much that he sent us, his children, as his representatives to them. So we can say to the people around us, he loved you so much that he sent me today to be here with you. He sent us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, in the midst of a world that is full of frightening things, frightening because we know we're not safe, frightening because we've seen murder. We've seen damage. We've seen people lose their way. We've seen people lose their houses. We've seen horrible things happen. We've been a part of it. It's happened to us. We've been a part of it happening to others, maybe. That in the midst of all that, when we ask, where were you? Where were you? How were you able to put up with that much human suffering? How could you not intercede? That you say to us, your followers, go intercede. Go. We thank you for the opportunity to be your loving arms, to be the loving voice, to speak into the lives of people who don't know you and say, he loves you. He does. You're broken. You're far from him, but he loves you. Come, taste, and see. Jesus, I pray today for all those who will hear your message, maybe not for the first time, or maybe for the first time, whoever they are, wherever they are, wherever they fall in the social strata, whatever ethnicity, whatever gender, whatever sins they might be involved in, whatever their family histories, whatever pains, all those people, I pray that today they would see you clearly and that they could choose themselves this day who they would serve. And I pray for us, so often terrified, so often like Thomas saying, well, I guess we could go along with Jesus and see what terrible thing might happen to us. I pray that in the midst of it, you would show us your glory and that we could be the ones who comfort Martha, who comfort Mary, who say to those who mourn, there is a time coming of resurrection and he is here and he loves you. In your name, amen.